Thanks for tuning into this episode of the Put a Fork in It podcast, the podcast delivering fresh perspectives at the intersection of food, health, business, and creativity. I'm your host, Kaylina Cahill, the founder and creative director of CC Photo and Media. CC Photo and Media is a Hudson Valley, New York-based photo-centric marketing company, providing visual services and consulting to regional and national businesses. A few updates on my end, in case you missed it, I have some work in Hudson Valley Magazine right now, the August issue from the Poughkeepsie Underwear Factory and North River Roasters. It is in the eat and drink section, including the cover of the section. And also, I announced in the last episode that I'll be participating in a raw artist showcase in October, October 25th in New York City. I will be debuting some new work that I haven't shown anywhere else yet. You can follow along with some stuff that I'm going to share leading up to the event on my Instagram at instagram.com/ccphotoandmedia or Facebook. There's an event page that I put up through the CC Photo and Media event, CC Photo and Media Facebook page. All right, and if you want to get tickets, you can go to rawartists.org/KaylinaCahill. And now for today's episode, I was very excited to be able to have this interview with Sarah Lee, the CEO of Think Duchess Alliance for Business. Think Duchess is the economic development organization for Dutchess County. And for those that don't know, Dutchess County is about 60 miles north of New York City, just right along the Hudson. And it's kind of between the Hudson and Connecticut. In any case, ever since I've been involved with the Hudson Valley Economic Development Corporation, which is a separate organization, I've wanted to have someone on the show to discuss what economic development is and the impact it has on our region and to learn a little bit more about the economic characteristics of this area. So we did some of this, but it turns out that our conversation covered a much wider breadth of content than just economic development and business. She is a Korean immigrant, so we got to hear a lot about her experiences as an Asian American, and we talked about food, cultural differences, growing up all over New York State as a Korean, how she got where she is in terms of her position at the organization Think Duchess, and of course, economic development. The conversation has a lot of information, and we also talked about why so many businesses fail and how to be more successful by using strategic planning and a strategic mindset. We talked about Think Duchess's newest initiative, the Innovation Challenge, and as far as I can tell, it's the first thing of its kind in the Hudson Valley. I'm sure there's things like it in the city, or you know, in San Francisco or the Silicon Valley, but here in the Hudson Valley, it's the first that I've heard of anything like it. Basically, it's a competition for pre-launch businesses and first stage businesses under 3 months old. I'll let you tell you more about it, but we talk about it at the end, so you got to stick around for the whole show. But if you like Shark Tank, then you're definitely going to want to hear about it and pay attention because there will be a live event on September 14th in Poughkeepsie. And now, without further ado, enjoy the show. Thanks for joining me on the podcast today, Sarah.
Thank you, Kaylina.
I'm really excited to talk about everything from the economic landscape of Dutchess County and the Hudson Valley, down to some tactics for people that are interested in either starting a business here or maybe moving their business, or just people that maybe are getting into the workforce. So let's jump right in.
Okay.
And why don't you give a little bit of your background, both personally and professionally, so that people can get an idea of who it is that I'm talking to here.
Well, I have been working in economic development for the past 4 years. Prior to that, I had my own consulting business. Prior to that, I was in healthcare, in management. And then prior to that, I was in advocacy and basically advocacy work and nonprofit. So personally, I'm Asian American. I came to this country as a young child. I have predominantly lived most of my life in New York State and all over New York State. I've been, you know, in New York City, all the way to, you know, upstate New York, the Buffalo Rochester area, the Capital
District. Really upstate.
Really upstate. You know, grew up skiing in the Adirondacks. Did my primary and secondary school in Rochester, Albany. Went to college in Troy. Graduate school in Syracuse. My husband's from Buffalo.
So which country did you move here from?
So I moved here from Korea. I became a U.S. citizen when I was 7.
How old were you when you moved?
So I moved when I was about a little over 2. About 2.
So you don't really remember anything from Korea? Or do you?
I don't remember as an infant, but all my relatives still live in Korea. And so it's only my immediate family that is in the U.S. And so I used to grow up, I used to spend my summers in Korea. I used to go almost every summer up until I was in high school. And then when I was in high school, I went twice in high school and twice in college. And I haven't been back in about, the last time I was in Korea was maybe about 15 years ago. And partly is the reason for that is I've had so many relatives come here and visit us. So I had no reason to go to Korea. But my children now are very curious.
So is Korean your first language?
So Korean is my first language. I am partially bilingual. I speak Konglish. It's a mix of English and Korean. I speak that to my parents. I can understand everything. I can read it. But when I speak it, I tend to mix both words in there, so I speak Konglish.
Can you write in Korean?
I can write a little bit in Korean. I can write a letter to my grandparents in Korean, but I wouldn't be able to write a novel.
I can relate. I mean, I speak French fluently. It's not because I'm of French descent or anything, but I studied it in school and then kept studying it and then lived in France. Uh-huh. And so I speak, franglais, in a way. I mean, like, English is obviously my first language, but like when I'm over there, I can get by, it's more than can get by, I can have deep philosophical conversations, right?
Yeah.
But I couldn't write a novel.
Yeah, yeah.
I can get by in business and things like that, and, rent an apartment and do all those things, but yeah, I wouldn't write a novel. It would also be kind of more like a children's book.
Yeah.
But I imagine that it's probably easier to learn French than Korean.
actually, I don't know, because I also studied French. Mm-hmm. For about 8 years from high school into college. And, I was, as an undergrad, I was an anthropology major, and I studied linguistics. And one of the things that came out is that Korean is actually considered one of the most efficient languages in the world.
Efficient and in what way?
Is that efficient because it can adapt to new words being introduced to the language. Like, unlike French
is
a word for computer. They're like, well, we can't call it computer, we have to call it, something else. In Korean, like, the word computer is computer, And they could, because the language is based on phonetics, it's easy to adapt new words into it. And there's only 24 letters in Korean, and it's just a matter of combination. So my children actually know how to read Korean.
How old are they?
They are 16 and 14. And the way we kind of introduced it to them is that it's almost like a secret code. When they were little, it's like a spy code. And these were the sounds, and you put them together.
That's so cool.
That's cool. So are they interested?
They are. My son is, interested from a historic point of view. My daughter is interested because she's really caught up in that K-pop culture. So, you know, it's actually quite amazing because her and her friends that aren't Asian are so much more into K-pop than she is in some ways, because we actually at home have access to Korean stations, and I actually watch a lot of Korean TV. So, you know, my kids, I think because they grew up with it in the background, they're not, you know, just fabric of their life. Whereas their, you know, my daughter's friends are all like, oh my gosh, this latest K-pop singer. And so, it's fun to see that. So, yeah, so they're interested.
And what about you in terms of learning English? How did that go?
So I actually didn't learn English until I started school in this country. So for the first 5 years of my life, I only spoke Korean. And then when I started nursery school or kindergarten, that's when I really started to learn English. And I was living in Flushing at the time. And the
for those that don't know, that's in Queens.
Yeah, that's in Queens.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's how I got the name Sarah. My parents just actually, you know, opened up the Bible. And said, oh, Sarah's a nice name.
So what's your Korean name?
So my Korean name is Hagyang.
How do you spell that?
It's
well, in Romanized letters.
So I would say it's Shukyung.
Say it again.
Spell.
No. Say it.
Hagyang.
Okay. So does anyone call you that anymore?
So all my relatives in Korea call me that, and actually some of when my parents emigrated here, so my father's a physician, and in the 60s and in the early 70s there was a thought that foreign trained physicians were better trained than American educated physicians. So if you were a physician from an Asian country, you know, all the way from Korea, Japan, China, India, it was easier to emigrate at that time. And so when my parents immigrated, there were a lot of their friends immigrated that my, you know, dad went to medical school with. And so a lot of my dad's friends who knew me when I was a baby still actually call me by my Korean name as well. So when we get together sometimes, they'll still.
How long did it take to get used to being called Sarah?
I actually don't remember. Again,
was it like right at the beginning of school? Or?
It was, I think, I have a very clear memory of having my name chosen, because it was, I was in the room, it was my mom and my dad and actually our minister, they had given me a couple choices, and Sarah was the one that resonated with me. And I think I was so excited to have an American name that it was relatively, you know, I picked it up fairly easily.
Okay.
I think it was harder in some ways for my parents to make that transition, because I don't think it was really until we moved to Rochester, at the time, and still the case, but at the time in upstate New York, you know, there just isn't a big Asian population.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they were calling me Sarah, so that other so that like our neighbors and you know people around there would also call me Sarah.
Okay.
And not be confused. The funny thing, a funny story, not to get off track.
It's fine.
That my brother was born in Rochester, New York. And in Korean, there's a word that you, my parents would always call him Eggy, and which means baby
mm-hmm.
in Korean, right? So
okay.
He's the youngest. And so my mom would say, oh, watch the baby. So she'd say, watch Eggy, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so my sister and I would call him Eggy. But his American name actually is Kenneth.
Okay.
It's Ken. We call him Ken. But all our neighbors thought his name was Eggy for a long time. And then finally we were like, no, his name is Ken. They're like, oh, really? Why do you call him Eggy? So.
Well.
So, being that your parents are the immigrants, and well, you're technically an immigrant too, but you came here at such a young age, so you're probably a little bit more adapted to like American culture. I mean, it probably relates sort of to, you know, how my boyfriend, who's Vietnamese, who was born here, but so it's first generation, but you know, that kind of thing where. In the house, it's one thing, and then everywhere else, it's another thing. So there's kind of a question of your cultural identity.
Yeah.
You know, how is that in terms of your background?
So I think the role of cultural identity in my life actually has had a big impact. I think that's what kind of drew me to become an anthropology major, to kind of that living and straddling two cultures. And in some ways, you know, my dad, again, I said was a physician, but he also taught medical schools. And so my dad was out, you know, kind of immersed, but my mom was a stay-at-home mom. And, you know, she had a hard time learning the language. And so often I grew up like being a translator for her. And I joke with, my siblings, because I'm the oldest, that I was their, you know, I think regardless in any culture, when you're the oldest child, you're the guinea pig child. But I tell my siblings that not only was I the guinea pig child, but I was their trailblazer for them, because like just little things like growing up, you know, sleepovers is a very Americanized thing. You go sleep over at your friend's house, but it's not a Korean. It's not in Korean culture, you don't really sleep over at your friend's house. So when I was younger and my friends would ask me to sleep over, my parents would be like, no, you can't sleep over, that's not, you know, proper, you know, behavior. And, you know, I would fight. And then by the time my sister or my brother wanted to sleep, my parents were like, oh yeah, no problem, just go there. And I'm just like, what? But, you know.
It's interesting. It's not something I ever would have thought of.
Yeah, it's just like really little things. And because we ate, growing up, we ate predominantly Korean food, you know, it wasn't until, the funny thing is, you know, I went to my friend's house and, you know, I encountered cereal and I'm like, oh, what's cereal? You know? And I come home and I would tell my parents, like, oh, there's, you know, there's this thing called cereal.
So tell me more about the food stuff.
So yeah, so we had, you know, growing up predominantly Korean food. So, which was really, I think, looking back at my mom, I give her a lot of credit because we grew up in areas where there weren't a lot of Asians. So she really had to adapt American ingredients from Korean. I do also remember, you know, relatives, like, sending us certain ingredients, you know, from
mm-hmm.
Korea so that she could, you know, cook with. But like we'd have, you know, rice and, you know, kimchi, which was really popular. She would make her own kimchi, you know, with cabbage and, you know, soups and actually a lot of, because a lot of the, she would make a lot of ingredients and food from scratch because it, like tofu,
mm-hmm.
she would actually
She made tofu from scratch?
Yeah. Wow. So her and her friends would all get together, and they would all collectively make, like, tofu from scratch. And then we would have, I remember, soybean paste and things like that. And I remember having, we call them mandu, but they're like dumplings, dumpling parties, where my mom and her friends would get together, and they would all make the different ingredients, and then we'd all put them together, kind of like Italian families do with ravioli and stuff. Mm-hmm.
Right. So what year was this, or like this around what time frame?
So you're making me date myself. Sorry.
If you don't want to, yes. You don't have to.
So it was in the 70s.
Okay. All right.
And so it was good. You know, the funny thing too is, you know, my uncle, my mom's youngest brother, went to graduate school at Columbia University. Eventually, I went to Korea by myself. My parents would send me. I think I was like 12 or 13 years old, and I was going to spend my summer in Korea. And my uncle had asked my mom if I could pack Big Macs and pizza in my suitcase because they didn't have a lot of American food, you know, in Korea. And he was missing like Big Macs and pizza. My mom was like, "There's no way I'm sending my daughter Big Macs."
That will not keep. I'm sure that the flight is like, what, like 15 hours?
Yeah, and back then I think it was even more because things weren't, you know, as fast and
school efficient as they are now. Yeah. So, you have to probably fly to California and then fly across the Pacific?
So,
or do you go through Europe?
No. So, they used to go to California and then across, and then to Japan and then to Korea. Then eventually went from Alaska to Japan to Korea, but now there's flights directly from like Detroit straight to Korea.
Really? There's enough of a market for Detroit to Korea?
So Detroit, because it's actually New York City to Detroit to Korea, and so there's actually a lot more flights now.
Well, because, yeah, that makes sense.
and Chicago to Korea, things like that, so.
Interesting. Huh. So when you were a kid, did you eat school lunches or did you bring Korean food to school?
So I ate school lunches. So I didn't really eat. I think, you know, again, my parents were very cognizant of, you know, not wanting me to stick up too much. I was very, other than sleepovers and certain little, you know, subtle things, you know, I ate school lunches, I was able to, you know, play with my friends. I grew up in the good old days where you, like, your parents, like, kick you out of the house right after you eat breakfast, and then they call you in that, you know, in the evening. that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. So, I think I had a very Americanized, you know, growing up. I was, you know, very Americanized. My parents are very Americanized. Actually, my husband is Korean as well. He came over when he was in junior high. And although I would say his parents are pretty Americanized as well, they are a little bit more traditional. Every so often we'll have a conversation, and my husband said, "Well, that's because your parents are more American."
Interesting.
So, the interesting thing about that is I say that my parents are like 1970 Koreans because they came to, 1972. So they came, you know, to the U.S. in the early 70s. And so they came with all the, I would say, the values and influences of that time. But during that time, even though they've gone back to Korea, Korea has changed culturally and socially. So my parents still have a lot of the cultural and social values of the early Korea of the early 70s,
mm-hmm.
and not necessarily of Korea like today. So it's interesting because, you know, I have a lot of relatives, and I actually have a lot of friends in Korea, and it's interesting to, when we talk, I'm like, oh, my parents are so old-fashioned.
So without going too far into it, can you give me a couple examples?
I think, like,
I don't know anything about Korea, so,
Yeah. so I mean,
other than, like, Korean barbecue
yeah, yeah.
and
so I would say,
kimchi.
So, yeah, exactly. So Korea is very, I don't know how to, what the word, right term is, but they respect age.
Oh, okay.
And
I understand that as an Asian value.
Right? They respect age, and they also respect title. And so there are very strict rules on, you know, this is what you call your older sister, this is what you call, you know, people who are younger than you, this is what you call, you know, your older sister, older brother, this is what you call your parents, this is what you call your boyfriend, and that's really, even though the culture is still the same, that you still have that respect, it's relaxed a little bit. So, like, for example, I'm gonna say girlfriend and boyfriend. So before, you were very strict on how you would address a boyfriend or girlfriend. You would use formal language and such. In now, between boyfriends and girlfriends, they don't use as formal language. They'll call each other, oppa, which is incredibly very familiar title to call your boyfriend. You know, back when my parents dated, it was like, you know, if you called your boyfriend that, it'd be like, you know, you're kind of like on Mars, and you know,
it would be disrespectful.
It'd be disrespectful. Now it's considered a term of endearment. So we often joke about that, like around, you know, family dinner, like, Mom, you should call Dad this, and my mom like. But it's really funny because I have a friend that I essentially call her my cousin because it's actually my mom's best friend's daughter. She and I are about the same age, and we're in contact. And she calls her husband oppa,
mm-hmm.
and you know, but my parents and her parents, you know, the thought of them calling each other that is like so foreign. So you know, little things like that. They're not
mm-hmm.
big cultural differences, but they're, you know, a little bit generational differences. So,
now that you're a parent yourself, how would you say that having like home cooked Korean meals has influenced how you interact with food in the home?
So my husband and I are major foodies. We actually travel, you know, and make our itinerary a lot of times around food. My kids are also, you know, interested in food. They've been exposed to all sorts of food. There's very little food that they will always try something, but there are very few foods that they don't like. Right now, if you talk to my son, he doesn't like zucchini because
zucchini is the best.
Yeah, right now, yeah, he doesn't like zucchini, but the thing is, he likes zucchini. He eats zucchini, but because zucchini is in season right now, it's like I've been using it in every.
Oh, so he's sick of it.
So he's kind of sick of it. So. So last night, he didn't eat dinner at home, so he thought that he was free from zucchini. He thought, oh, I don't have zucchini. But it ended up that I didn't use zucchini, and I was going to use the zucchini tonight for dinner. So my son doesn't know yet.
Oh no, too bad for him.
So we're real foodies, and you know, my kids have been exposed to all sorts of foods from different cultures. So. Funny thing is, when my son was in elementary school, I actually packed him sushi for lunch, and it kind of broke my heart, but I understood it, is that he came home later, you know, that day, he's like, Mom, can you just pack me sandwiches, because I think a lot of the kids, just, it was, you know, how many kids go to school with sushi?
Right.
Which is very different because my daughter actually likes, you know, when I pack her, you know, these Korean, you know, rolls, seaweed rolls, which is very similar to like a maki roll in Japanese. That's her favorite lunch. So, so yeah, so they have very, it's very multicultural in my house. And I think it has brought, you know, I traveled a lot, you know, around the world, so has my husband. And, you know, that we want to bring that same experience and open-mindedness to our children. And we do that a lot through food.
That's really interesting. Yeah, so, I mean, this is also a food podcast, so, you know, that's why we're kind of talking about it for a little bit longer than maybe we might have otherwise. But now we can start to transition a little bit into, you know, how did you wind up in Poughkeepsie in economic development?
So that's a funny story. So I say my life is a series of serendipitous accidents. My husband was, he has worked for IBM for a very long time. When we got married, he was working for IBM. I was working in the city in healthcare management at NYU Medical Center. We had been married for a few years, and we decided, we were living in Westchester, and we had been married for a few years, and we had decided that, you know, it's time for us to start a family. But we knew that Westchester may not be where we would want to start our family. So we started exploring other, you know, possible places that could, that we were looking at. And actually, we had decided on Boston, and I had found a job in Boston. He was interviewing for a job in Boston, and he brought home the Poughkeepsie Journal, and he had, and in our 4 years of marriage before that, he had never brought home, you know, anything from Poughkeepsie. And in the Poughkeepsie Journal was the Help Wanted sections. I looked at it, and there was a description for the director of strategic planning for Vassar Brothers Medical, Vassar Brothers Hospital. And I'm like, hey, that's what I do for NYU. You know, let me just put it in, you know, my resume and just to see. And I submitted my resume, and I actually got the job. They offered me the job. The job entailed that at the time Vassar Brothers Hospital wanted to be a medical center and wanted to become HealthQuest. So I helped them. I was their VP of Strategic Planning and New Business Development, and helped them form HealthQuest. Had my son in the process, and then 9/11 happened. I lost two friends in 9/11. And,
I'm sorry.
And it really impacted me, and I was just like, okay, what am I doing, you know? So I decided to, after talking over with my husband, we decided that I would stop working and be home with my son. Was home with my son, and I loved every moment. I think I'm fortunate that I was able to be able to make that choice. I know a lot of people aren't able to make that choice. But I was able, you know, fortunate to be able to make that choice and be home with my children for a good portion of their life, or at least their life living at home with us.
Right.
But at the same time, I'm the type of person who likes to do a lot of stuff. So after a few years, you know, let me go back because now I'm being forgetful. So I decided to stay home. A lot of people I used to work with found out that I was staying home and then called me and said, oh, would you be interested in doing some consulting work while you're home? So I was like, yeah, I guess I could do a project or two while I'm home. So that actually blossomed into me doing consulting work. I did a lot of consulting work, mostly for hospitals and helping them do regulatory affairs, compliance, things like that. Transitioned into nonprofit consulting, helping them do strategic planning, capacity building, things like that. Eventually, what happened was a job opening was in this organization, and my neighbor was a former executive director of the organization, and she says, you have to apply. And I was like, but I have no experience in economic development. And she said, don't worry about it. You can do it. And so I applied. This was 4 years ago. And then 2 years ago, I was put into my position as CEO. So it's been a great ride. I've enjoyed it immensely. I still enjoy it immensely. I love coming to work, you know, every day. I love, one of the aspects I love about my job is to be able to help people, you know, basically with their livelihood, you know, and also in a way it impacts the quality of life for me and my family, you know, indirectly, because it all contributes to, you know, the vitality of the county. So that's what brought me to Poughkeepsie, was just this wanted ad.
So your husband was working for IBM?
Yes. So, and he still works for IBM.
So in the Poughkeepsie?
In Poughkeepsie, yeah. Okay. Yeah.
So then Westchester made sense because it was between Poughkeepsie. Yes, exactly. So, okay, I see. All right. So how long were you staying at home?
So I was home with my kids up until my kids were in middle school, you know. So it was a good, you know, 10-12 years of their lives. And, you know, I enjoyed it immensely. I think it was, for me, a real privilege to you know, be there. As much as the day-to-day tediousness of, like, having to drive them here and there and things like that, I do miss those days. When I see children of that age, I'm like, oh, I remember those days. Because now my children are teenagers, and they're, like, really embedded in, like, being teenagers. I just remember, at 12, they just listen to you just a little bit better than they do when they're 16.
And it's only going to get worse.
So I guess it's also a godsend that I am working right now, so it just, you know, relieves... I'm a little bit away from that. But also, I'd have to say, you know, being a woman, I also consider myself a feminist, and I have a daughter. Mm-hmm. And I want to show both my son and daughter that, you know, they have choices in their lives, you know, that they can make those choices, and they can make it work. You know, mm-hmm. It's all about, and it's all about how to make that work, you know, to see what you want in life. To be happy with that, and you know, be not afraid to take risks. You know, that's the biggest thing that I'm trying to teach my kids, is don't be afraid to take risks. I've taken a lot of risks. I think the biggest risks I took was right after graduate school. I went to work in Washington D.C. as a junior lobbyist. I was, you know, did data collection for my bosses, who were the real lobbyists. And one day, my friends from college, they're all living in New York City, I was talking to one of them, and she was like, why are you living in D.C.? You should move to New York. That's where everything is. So I said, okay. So I went into work the next day, and I put in notice. 2 weeks later, I moved to New York. I didn't have a job. I didn't have a place to live. And, you know, I lived on my friends' couches for probably 2 weeks before I found a place, and I was able to find a temporary job. I was covering for somebody who was on maternity leave, and then that was able to float me enough until I found, you know, the job that a career level job. But, you know, looking back, I'm like, wow, I really took a big risk, like, you know, doing that. But you know, if I hadn't done that, it wouldn't have led me to do what I'm doing now, and to not be afraid of that. Mm-hmm.
So what are you doing now?
So I am now, you know, the CEO of Think Duchess, and Think Duchess is the economic development organization for Duchess County. And what that means is I oversee the efforts to attract businesses to come to Dutchess County. Those businesses that are currently doing business in Dutchess County, I try to keep them here. I try to foster growth and expansion for those companies, and services for startups that, you know, people who live here and thinking, well, you know, I think I want to start a business in the county. So I think that just, I would say, is the one, I like to think it's the one-stop shop for businesses.
Mm-hmm.
We don't provide a lot of direct services ourselves as Think Duchess, but we are a resource center and we know where to send you know, people based on what their business needs are, and we cut out, you know, a lot of time and hassle for that business, because if they need technical advice, we say this is the person that you need to talk to, and the technical advice versus them being at home and doing Google searches and, you know, that, you know, because they're busy trying to start a business. You know, they don't need to be on the computer doing Google searches, you know, up until like 1 a.m. saying, I wonder if that's the person I need to call. And then up calling them and saying, oh, no, you need to call them. And then end up calling that office and, you know, calling somebody else. So we cut that all out. And it becomes very efficient for that business that comes to us. You know, to kind of dive a little bit deeper, you know, how we do other things is that one of the ways, basic ways that we attract businesses to Dutchess County is through marketing. We market the county as a great place to live, work, and play, and Dutchess County. And so how we do that is we published our first magazine this year.
I did see that on the website.
Yep, it's just available on our website, and I'm glad you brought up our website. Our award-winning website, which we launched.
I saw that too.
which we launched in January this year, and I'm like super excited that it was recognized this year by the New York State Economic Development Council as best-in-class website for economic developers. I'm not sure I'm supposed to say this publicly, but it'll be close to when this podcast airs, is the International Economic Development Council has also given us a gold award for our website.
Congratulations.
And thank you. So I'm very
I mean, excited. It is a really nice website. I was impressed by it.
So I think, you know, our competition is stiff because there's, you know, every county has at least one economic development, you know, organization, and then you multiply that by the United States and the world, and then to get the Gold Award, I think, is a great honor. So,
congratulations. So speaking of, you know, other counties and other economic development organizations, so suppose somebody is looking either to start a business in the Hudson Valley,
mm-hmm.
at large, or they are looking to move their business from someplace else, and they're kind of evaluating where they want to go.
Yeah.
How much are you guys able or willing to help someone in that stage when they maybe aren't committed to Dutchess County,
uh-huh.
But it's one of the places they're considering? How much would you help them versus refer them to other area economic development people?
So we try to help them as much as we can. You know, my first choice always is in the interest of the county and to track them to the county. But if for some reason Dutchess County doesn't suit their needs, we will try to keep them, you know, in the region.
Mm-hmm.
We don't want to lose them, you know, outside the region to another state, because we recognize that, you know, rising tide floats all boats. So if they can't be in Dutchess County, you know, hopefully in the region. That being said, we, you know, do our best to help them, you know, consider our region very seriously. We have a lot of services, you know, that can benefit a business, all the way from a one-person startup business to that multi-corporate, you know, national corporation. You know, services in our office include, you know, that person that's, you know, maybe developed an app,
mm-hmm.
you know, and they're just that one person, and they're the one doing the coding, but they're like, you know what, I think I, you know, want to set up shop. This is where I like living here. I love the lifestyle, being at, you know, access to the river, to the mountains, you know, just the the quality of life is really good. I want to set up shop. You know, they can come in here. We can help them, you know, put together a business plan because they're growing and they want financing. We can put that, you know, put a business plan together, put a marketing plan together. They want to hire people. We connect them with the Workforce Investment Board. There's on the job, you know, which is a federal program. There's on the job training dollars. There's grant money. There's, let's say they are a minority or women-owned business. We have the Women's Enterprise Development Center that helps certify businesses to be get their MWBE so that they are more attractive to government contracts.
Yeah, I'm actually going through that process right now.
And it's a lengthy and, you know, difficult process for someone to
I'm working with WEDC.
Exactly. I mean, and I think you could probably, you would agree with this, is that if WEDC wasn't here and you had to do that by yourself.
You know? The laugh says it all.
Yeah.
There's so many papers.
Yeah, and so we have that person. You don't have to do that by yourself, you know. So, that's really what it is that these people, you know, we recognize that it is already really difficult to start a business, you know, especially in today's economy. And we're here to say you don't have to do that by yourself. You know, we have a lot of resources here to help you. Even in our office, you know, we use the same database that real estate brokers use. So we know what property is out there, and based on what your needs are, if you need, you know, 1,000 square feet to 300,000 square feet, you know, we can help you with that. We don't act as brokers. We don't get involved in the transaction, but what we do is we connect you with the business and real estate, you know, the broker owner, so that you can see the choices out there, and you know, and then you guys negotiate that on your own. So we have you know, a lot of services. We can connect people, businesses to workforce. We're very lucky in Dutchess County because we have so many higher education institutions. We have Dutchess Community College. We have Marist. We have Vassar. We have Bard. We have the Culinary Institute. And so, you know, if a business is coming here and they want to do some R&D or they want to do, you know, have interns so they can get permanent employees, we're able to connect that with them. You know, also if you're an existing business and you're like, you know, I'd like my staff to brush up on, you know, manufacturing math or safety skills, we can connect them with, you know, the resources to do that.
Mm-hmm. What do you think is the most underutilized service that you have?
I would say it's not necessarily my service, is the on-the-job training dollars that are available to employers. I think that's my favorite program. That's the number one referral that I make to businesses, is on, you know, the federal on-the-job training program. If it's grant money, it depends on the job classification and what training, on-the-job training is involved. But what the program does is it can subsidize a new hire salary for 6 months, and then the person training them for up to 3 months. So I would say, again, it all depends on the type of job and what training is involved in that job, but it can be, you know, considerable amount of money, you know, and considerable amount of savings, because the whole concept about behind that program is that when you hire somebody new, they don't have completely all the skills they need to know when they start the job, so they're not 100% productive. So it takes them, you know, up to 6 months to be fully productive. And the same thing, the person training them is not, again, loses productivity because they're training somebody.
Right.
So that money that you get through on-the-job training subsidizes that, you know, that loss in productivity that a business may have. And so it is a little bit of paperwork, but again, our WIB is incredibly helpful in walking somebody through that process. It's not a difficult process.
What are some of the qualifying factors?
So some of the qualifying factors is that retail jobs tend not to qualify. The jobs that do the best are jobs related to manufacturing, because there's a big focus both at the federal and state level on manufacturing jobs. So manufacturing jobs tend to benefit the most out of this program. They have to pay the, because of this federal program, they have to pay the minimum federal wage and the maximum of like $24.99. For a manufacturing job, they can get subsidized up to 60% of the new hire salary for 6 months. And the person training them, I believe it's 30% for 3 months. So.
And is it only for full-time or is it also for part-time?
I believe it's for full-time, but it might also qualify for part-time. I don't know the exact details when it gets that.
Mm-hmm. Is there a minimum revenue or company size?
No. Anybody can qualify. As long as the important thing to remember about this program is that some training needs to be involved, some on-the-job training that proves that there is a jump in skill set.
Is it meant for people that are new that are new to the workforce or people that are transitioning careers?
Both.
Okay.
So it could be somebody who graduated from Dutchess Community College in Dutchess Community College has a new program where they give a certificate about cybersecurity. Somebody has that certificate and now they can work in cybersecurity. They work for a company, but they are very specialized in cybersecurity. So this person has the general skills to work in cybersecurity, but now they go to a company and they're going to learn more skills specific to this company. There's a training aspect involved
right.
in that. So it can be somebody who is transitioning careers, who is just entering a career.
And is this something that a business would have to disclose to the new employee or no?
What do you mean?
That they're being paid through this program.
I think it's up to that business, but in some ways, I don't think the employee would mind, because without the program, the chances are that they would be hired would be less, because it helps the business, and the person's salary doesn't get affected. They get paid what they get paid.
Interesting.
So it just what it is for the employer, it's to make up any loss in productivity, because somebody, and I'll liken it to a manufacturing job. If they're supposed to be making, really be in simplistic terms, as they're supposed to make a product like your recording device. Somebody who is at full productivity can maybe make 100 of those recording devices a day. But if you're learning and you're being trained to make one, you may only make 50 good ones,
mm-hmm.
for the first 6 months, because you're learning all the parts and pieces. And the person who's training you may know how to make 100 a day, but because he's training you, or he or she's training you, she may only make 70 or 80 a day. So therefore, you're kind of making less product, and until that person's trained. So that, that's to make up the loss of productivity.
So you seem to be talking a lot about manufacturing.
Yeah.
What are the industries that are really thriving here?
So our three biggest industries in Dutchess County are healthcare, education, and manufacturing, advanced manufacturing. I would include also that tech into manufacturing, because the type of tech we have here, I would say, is in some forms manufacturing. It's just because of the way the federal government classifies them as IT jobs, but I would argue that they're more like manufacturing jobs than they are IT jobs.
Okay. And what are the fastest growing industries here?
So tech is actually, I would say, one of the fastest growing industries here. A lot to do with that is Hudson Valley Tech Meetup has really brought to the focus, you know, to the surface, you know, the people who live here who are in tech, in the tech industry. That's really hot. I would say tourism. You know, every year tourism, we see more growth in tourism. So those are, I think, the two fastest growing industries here.
And are you speaking specifically about Dutchess County or the region?
I would say Dutchess County and the region. Okay. You know, it's, you know, Dutchess County is not necessarily in its own bubble.
Right.
You know? So region-wise, you know, we're seeing a lot of that in the region. Food, you know, and beverage is really, really big. In Dutchess County, and you know, and the region as well.
So, what aspects of tech are here?
So, I would say the full gamut of tech. I mean, you know, IBM manufactures, you know, the high, you know, those really powerful servers, and then we have people who do coding, and people who do, you know, cybersecurity, people who manufacture the box, you know, the cases that the, you know, the servers go in. We have companies that, you know, we have a lot of companies that work in defense in, you know, very high-tech areas. So we run the gamut when it comes to tech. I mean, we're not as big as, you know, Silicon Valley, but...
naturally.
You know, naturally. But we have everything. I mean, I think we have everything. We're not, you know, there's no one big... you know, big thing. I mean, we have, you know, and we make semiconductors in Fishkill still. Global Foundries is still there. So we do everything, in, you know. So,
And how about what kinds of jobs and businesses are here for food and beverage?
So food and beverage, we have, you know, we can consider, you know, your microbreweries like Millhouse, Blue Collar, you know, North River Hops, which is a, you know, husband and wife that's just starting out. We have, I would say, almost along the supply chain. I mean, we grow hops in the county. We brew beer in the county. Millhouse has been very successful in distributing their beer outside, you know, internationally. We same thing with spirits. You know, we have Dutch spirits that grow their own grain. They, you know, distill it. We have Millbrook Winery, which is an internationally known. Winery, we have and a lot of that is, you know, credited to the culinary. We have top restaurants, you know, in the county. I think one of the reasons, I mean, we're seeing more and more of them, but one of the reasons, I think, for a long time that we didn't see a lot of chain restaurants enter Dutchess County as opposed to other counties nearby us is because we had such a proliferation of high quality restaurants that graduates from the culinary would open. And so a lot of these larger restaurants didn't necessarily see a need, you know, to open up here because they're like, well, people are eating out at these, you know, high quality restaurants that, you know, not necessarily would go to a chain. So, you know, we're seeing a lot, you know, in the food and beverage. We have, in terms of food, you know, a lot of high quality restaurants and food products all the way from, you know, my brother Bobby's salsa to, you know, sauces and, you know, all that stuff we mm-hmm. make here. So, you know, that's a growing industry. We don't necessarily have a lot of infrastructure, necessarily like commercial kitchen, incubators in the county right now, but we are seeing a demand for that, and so I wouldn't be surprised in the near future that we were going to see, you know, some more, you know, we do see some co-working spaces in the county. I would almost liken that to, like, co-cooking.
Yeah, I know spaces. About at least one, the Poughkeepsie Underwear Factory.
Yes, so we have the, and that's the first one, you know, that's grown out of demand, and we're mm-hmm. seeing that, and I wouldn't be surprised if we see more and bigger, on bigger scale, So it is, you know, it is definitely a, you know, a growing industry here. So, mm-hmm. So yeah, so, you know, I think Dutchess County right now, in terms of economics and, you know, starting a business here, it's a really exciting time. I mean, those businesses that have that frontier spirit, you know, this is a great place to do that, because it's almost, you know, I say it's the Wild West with structure. and what I mean by that is that there's so much room for creativity here, because there are, it's a hotbed for creativity, but at the same time, we've had heritage, we have heritage manufacturers in the county. We have IBM. We have businesses like Schatz Bearing that have been here for 100 years, and EFCO that's been here, you know, for 100 years. That we have that structure of how to support businesses, how to foster growth, and we know how to do that. But at the same time, there's all this creative, you know, you can be creative, but also have a safety net. You know, going back to my children, I encourage them to have to take risks at this point in their life, because they can, it's, they're safe risks. They can take a risk, but they're, you know, we, my husband and I are here to help them if that choice doesn't go that well, you know? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And so the same thing with businesses, you know, they can afford to take that risk. You know, rents are cheaper here than they are in Brooklyn, and, you know, so if you're going to start that app company, start it here, because your overhead is less, your risk is less because of that. We have the employment, we have the space, we have the access to New York. Brooklyn, you know, if you fail, you may end up with a big, you know, you've taken a lot of risk there, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah, where rent there is probably, you know, a few thousand dollars a month for a tiny little apartment, and here you could get a whole house for that.
Exactly. Right? Exactly. Yeah, you can if you're going to start a business here, you can afford to buy a house and have office space. You know, in your Brooklyn, you're probably running a business out of your one bedroom or studio apartment.
Or your loft.
Or your loft, you know, things like that. And because of Metro North, it's very easy to have access to New York City. And because of technology and internet, you have, you know, all those like Skype and, you know, GoToMeeting, that you can have those online meetings and have access to people. So, you know, that's why I think Dutchess County is a great place to start a business.
What does it mean to foster growth?
So to foster growth, again, is to, if a company gets to a point where, all right, you know, I want to roll out a new product line, or I'm doing great, people are buying my product, and I need more people to, I need to hire more people, or, you know, my space is too small, I need a bigger space. We're able to do that. We have all the services available.
Right, so they might come to you and say, okay, so we're outgrowing our space, and you connect them with the real estate people.
Exactly.
Or, you know, we need to hire a new person, so you connect them with the workforce development, or, you know, with...
with Dutchess Community College, with, or Marist, with any of the, you know, local institutions. Exactly. And then also through those companies that are going to invest a lot of money to... do growth, and what I mean a lot is probably over $4 to $5 million, then the Industrial Development Agency can help them. And that, I'm also the executive director of the Industrial Development Agency. And what the Industrial Development Agency does is offers tax incentives in exchange for job creation. Hmm. So they're usually reserved for larger projects, you know, that my board likes to see projects that are transformative, they're tax incentives in form of a payment in lieu of taxes, sales tax, mortgage tax.
So if somebody comes to you and they have an idea for a product that they want to make and sell, but there you have never been in business before.
Yes.
What would you say is the first thing that they should do?
The first thing I would say is get a business plan. Because the exercise of putting a business plan together will really challenge somebody to say, is this really what I want to do? And will it be successful? Because it really will weed out what's a hobby and what's a business. And I will say putting a good business plan is not easy, but it'll be the easiest thing and the most important thing for a business person to do, because we often joke, but it's real, it's like if a person is not motivated to put a business plan together and thinks that they can do a business, a thriving business of what they imagine a business is going to be without a business plan, they will go through a tremendous amount of, it'll be much harder for them to get to that point, and the likelihood that they will fail will increase. So my first word of advice is, if you're thinking about doing a business, you know, put a business plan together, because that will really, you know, frame that. Because, and we have a lot of services, that will help a business do that. You know, we have WEDSI, we have the Small Business Development Center, we have SCORE. All those organizations provide free business technical advice. WEDSI is a little bit different because after a certain point they will be charging a fee because they offer classes. But, you know, their fees, I would say, is very reasonable. We get businesses that come in and, you know, they'll be selling, and I'm going to completely make this up, but they'll be selling socks for cats, you know? Mm-hmm. And we'll ask them, well, so who's your customer? And they'll be like, every person that owns a cat.
Oh my God, that's what every restaurant owner tells me when I ask them, who's your target market? And they say, or who's your ideal client? They say, everyone, anyone who eats, everybody has to eat. No.
And you're like, no, not everyone is going to like the type of food that you cook. Or, you know, they do that. So I'm like, not everyone's going to want socks for their cat. You
know? Not every cat owner wants socks for the cat.
Yeah, exactly. So really putting a business plan together really puts that, you know, really challenges that owner. Oh, maybe you're right. Maybe it's only, you know, that subset of, you know, things like that. And then that really challenges that person to say, okay, well, then if it's only like 10% of cat owners that are going to want socks for the cats, you know, what does that mean in terms of dollars for me and how much it's going to cost for me to create my product and to meet my market demand and things like that. So I think it makes it more realistic to do that.
So how would you recommend that somebody evaluate whether a market is going to be supportive to their business idea?
So there's actually a lot of data out there to help businesses. One of them is data that actually is available, you know, through our website is demographics. You can also go to, Federal Census Bureau and find out, you know, how many people, if their audience is going to be 18 to 40-year-olds, they can see how many of that live in that community or that region. And then just market research. There's a lot available on the internet. And a lot of times, these organizations that I've named earlier, like WEDSI, SCORE, and SBDC, can guide that business based on what their product on of, you may want to go, if you're, you know, going to make socks for cats, you may want to go to Petco and see if there are socks for cats. You know, like things like that. Or you may go, you know, and go to the pet store and see how much they would cost, you know, they're going for. Go on Etsy or go, you know, things like that to just do some research to see if a product, like your a similar product exists, you know, if so, how much they're going for, or if it's different than yours, what makes yours, you know, a competitive advantage of yours, things like that. So there's a lot of research involved, and I think that's a good exercise for a new business owner going into a new venture to really realistically see, okay, you know, will my product succeed or not, you know?
So if you're in food and beverage, you know, a sidecar of food and beverage, specifically niching down into like healthy food or fitness or things like that,
What kinds of things might they look for when they're reading the demographics or reading, you know, the statistics about a market? What kind of things might they look for?
So I would say they should look, you know, again, age demographics, the number of healthcare facilities that are in the area, the number of gyms. Maybe they could, you know, go to the chamber, look at how many personal trainers are in the area, how many healthy eating choices there are in the area.
Mm-hmm.
You know, hook up with, there's a lot of, you know, if they, I would say even if they go to meetup groups and do research on how many meetup groups there are about people who are gluten-free or,
mm-hmm.
you know, things like that, to just really assess, okay, there's a real interest in this type of eating. How strong is the farm-to-table movement and where, you know, where I'm going to be? Things like that that might, you know, that could be potential customers and could be, you know, potential competitors.
Mm-hmm.
And just get assessment of, you know, is there a real need and serve, you know, or for my product or my service?
When you're looking at the data, it doesn't necessarily indicate that there's an already a presence of that,
uh-huh.
but that doesn't necessarily mean that it couldn't work, you know? So how could you kind of go from seeing what is currently to say, okay, well, it's not currently here in a big way, but how might you be able to evaluate whether there is enough of an interest growing for something? Because, I mean, that's kind of what an entrepreneur does,
yes.
you know?
Yes.
Is like, if there's already like 20 trillion gyms, maybe the market's saturated.
Yeah.
Right?
Like,
so.
Yeah. No, exactly. So, you know, being an entrepreneur, part of that is taking risk and just kind of like jumping in, you know?
Right.
Right? And just saying, a lot of it, what I admire about entrepreneurs, a lot of it is passion, you know, passion for their product, because, you know, it could be based on a personal story, like that person's dietary needs, and
mm-hmm.
they have realized, I'm shopping at every grocery store in the community, but, you know, and it could be good, but I have to make it my own, you know, I've realized that I can't find what I need, and I have to make it my own, you know. That's similar to the story of my mom, you know, growing,
mm-hmm.
making Korean food. She couldn't find Korean, you know, ingredients, and so her and her friends would make it, you know, on their own. So you do that from a personal, you know, standpoint, and then you just start small, you know, and a lot of it's marketing. A lot of it is just pushing yourself and inserting yourself. And that, you know, and most of the time that works, you know, you
mm-hmm.
just, and I think, in today's environment, it's in some ways easy and challenging because we have social media and it's easy to put your product up there, but it's hard work because you just can't, just putting it up on the internet is not, you know,
Oh, you mean I can't just put up a website and expect to have all sorts of sales?
Yeah, exactly. You still have to pass the payment. You know, you still have to go to the grocery store and say, hey, I make this great granola bar, you know?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's different because it has all these different ingredients, and it's really, really good for people who, you know, have these dietary, you know, issues. And it's really good for, because, you know, we have a large population of people who like to do relay races or those obstacle races and,
mm-hmm.
you know, things like that. So, you know, and, you know, if you are selling, like, let's say, granola bar, that your potential customer, someone who does those obstacle courses, you find out, okay, these are all the obstacle courses that are in my area that I can easily travel to and, you know, maybe try to get in with the operator and see if I can give out my granola bar for free, you know, things like that. So, And actually, that is all in a business plan, you know, because
mm-hmm.
marketing is essential for a new business. And I think one of the mistakes that a new business fails to consider is marketing. And because people concentrate on making the product, but not necessarily getting rid of their product. You know? I should just say it nicer.
Yeah, no, I know.
No, but I tend to agree with that because I work in marketing, and a lot of people have told me, you know, oh, well, you know, we don't have the budget for that.
Yeah.
But how can you not? Because that's how people find out about your product. Yeah. So what would you say, other than just saying, like, you know, social media or get a website, you know, where do you think people, small business owners that don't have a huge budget, where do you think they'll get the most bang for their buck or return on their investment, whether time or money?
So I would say go where your customers are, go where your network might be. So I always tell businesses, chamber, you know, join the local, if you can afford it, you know, go to the local chamber and be a member, because the chamber, our Dutchess County Regional Chamber is incredible. It is a great place to network. Get your, you know, your word out of your product. They, you know, every chamber, as incredible as our chamber is, every chamber, regardless of, you know, it's our chamber, any chamber in the, you know, in the world, you get out what you put in. And, you know, our chamber offers a tremendous amount of opportunity for businesses to network, get their word out. If the chamber, you know, is not in your budget to
join. Actually, you can go to a lot of their events for free anyway.
Yes, yes.
Without and being a member.
Exactly.
Because I used to do that.
Yeah, exactly, yes. They have free events. Is, you know, join a, you know, a networking group. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of, you know, networking groups out there. You know, look at meetup groups. Mm-hmm. Go to events, friends and family.
What if you want to adapt your strategic mindset to this? So if someone is a new business owner, or maybe they've been in business for a little bit, and they're kind of like, okay, it's time to do some marketing, like, but they're not very strategic in how they think. Yeah. How might you guide them to be more strategic?
Yes, to be more strategic. So again, I would refer them to Small Business Development Center, to WEDC, because they offer services and classes on, you know, strategy and how to market your product, and, you know, things that you have to put in place as your business grows. Like, a company's going to have to consider risk management. You know, what is my risk if I do this versus, you know, if I make this choice versus that choice, if I change this ingredient versus that ingredient? You know, what is the liability that someone might have an allergic reaction to my product, and how do I handle that if that happens? So those are important things to consider, that new businesses don't always have the luxury, you know, and unfortunately, you know, don't always consider until something, you know, bad happens. But, you know, a lot of business owners are very good at making what they're selling and don't necessarily have that strategic mindset. And that's one of the things that we can provide them, is the resources to do that. And, you know, tell them, once they get to a certain size, maybe it's time for them to hire a salesperson. Maybe it's time for them to hire, you know, a bookkeeper or a CFO or somebody who can help them think more strategically, you know, put a strategic plan together. And there are some resources to do that. And a lot of the resources that our office provides are free. Mm-hmm. So
what is a strategic plan?
So
I mean, I think I know.
Yeah,
but
yeah. So a strategic plan, I liken that to a map, you know? And I say, you know, a strategic plan is, I'm going to go across country, and I have a map, and I want to land, you know, in California. And so I will map out my route to how to get to California. And, you know, yes, I'm driving, and, hey, I might take a detour here and, you know, see what Cleveland has to offer, but then I get on my route, back on my route, and eventually, after a week or 2 weeks, I'm in California. If I don't have a strategic plan, the chances that I will land in Canada are probably much higher than if I don't have a map. And so that's what I think a strategic plan is. A strategic plan is a plan that gets me to my goal, but allows me some flexibility to explore other options, but eventually, you know, I'm able to, I see a plan to get to my goal, you know, and not get me off course and put me in a place where I get to California and I have no, I mean, I get to Canada and I have no money left to go to California. So, you know, and strategic planning is integral. As a business, it may not be as important for a new business or just starting out, but it, as a business starts to grow, I think a strategic plan becomes more and more important and integral in, you know, the sustainability and success of a business.
So what, how would you define strategic thinking?
So strategic thinking is thinking one step ahead of where you are. You know, it's kind of a little bit of a chess game. I would say a lot of people, it's very difficult to think strategically. And, you know, I think, you know, you mentioned it can be very challenging for business to think strategically because that person doesn't have that strategic mindset.
Right. Yeah, because they're very focused on the day-to-day.
Exactly.
And it's hard to imagine what the future might be like and how to get there.
Yes, exactly. So it is, you know, and it is a little bit, you know, I think there's imaginative thinkers and practical thinkers. And strategic thinking is a little bit of imaginative, you know, thinking because it's that, what do I want to be when I grow up, you mm-hmm. know, kind of thinking.
Right, but it doesn't stop at what do I want to be when I grow up. It's more like what do I want to be to grow up and what do I have to do that.
Exactly.
Right, so it's sort of like the, like for lack of a better way to say it, kind of the love child between the imaginative and the practical thinking.
Exactly.
It's like what, it's like the middle.
Yes. It's just kind of like okay, if I want to get here, what stepping stones do I need to jump on to get there versus, you know, someone who's a practical thinker is like, okay, I got to make sure I have enough product to sell in my store to meet my customer demand for today.
Right. Know? Instead of, well, but if I make a larger production, you know, that might last me for a year. And then if I have all of it ready for the whole year, then I can focus on other things at the same time.
Exactly.
But maybe I don't have the actual budget to really do that. So how can I actually make it so that I have the budget so that I can produce all of the product for a whole year? Like, what do I have to do to make that happen?
Exactly.
Because then you can focus on other aspects of the business throughout that year in order to grow in other ways. And then you've also created a system for yourself to be able to do, you know, an annual production.
Yes.
Instead of, you know, every other week or something.
Yes, exactly. You know? Exactly. And also to how am I going to ensure that I'm going to have enough customers to always want my product? Because you will have, you know, every business has a customer that might move, that can, you know, no longer afford your product, you know, things like that. So how do I make sure that I'm always going to get that, you know, customer base to come in to when I create a year's worth of product?
Right. You know, yeah, how can you guarantee that you're going to have the customers to sell it to? Right?
Exactly. So so those are all strategic thinking, you know, and not so much like, okay, got to make, you know, 100 jars of this stuff to, you know, survive today.
So if you're like a one person or maybe two person business in the area and you're really stuck in the like day-to-day mindset, what might you suggest to them to try and learn more strategic thinking or apply more strategic processes, I guess, for lack of a better way? How would you get them to see the light on that?
Well, I think all business owners have some level of, I mean, we all dream, right? We all dream. And when we start a business, you know, we have a dream for ourselves when we start this business, right? We may not want to be, we may not dream to be the next, you know, owner, you know, creator of Facebook, or, you know, maybe we do, I don't know, but, you know, we all have, you know, I want to create this product because our motivations, you know, can run the gamut to like make this a better world, be able to support me and my family, or I'm going to be, you know, the richest person in the world, but they all have that kind of dream aspect of, you know, and I think when you do start a business, it's not easy, you know, you are really in the day-to-day, and you lose that aspect of dreaming, and I think when they're connected to services that we are able to provide, like putting together a business plan, like putting together a strategic plan, putting together a marketing plan, things like that, that it reignites that and says, oh yeah, I did have a dream for myself, you know, and this is the path that I need to take. And I don't think it's a hard leap, because if they're, the other key I say in that is that it's the relationship, you know, it's a our relationship to that one or two person business owner, and, you know, being helpful to them, because as great as Wetsy is, as great as Score is, as great as SBDC is, sometimes a business will go to SBDC and they just don't click with that person. I always say, go to Score, see if you click with that person. You know, go to Wetsy, see if you click with that person. Because all those three organizations are fantastic, but it's also a relationship, you know, and plugging into that. Because these are important aspects of a business. And, you know, like I said before, we're a support center, we're a resource center. Mm-hmm.
So before we wrap up in a little bit, I know that you guys have this innovation challenge competition. Yes. That you're doing. So tell me, what is that? How did it come about?
So the innovation challenge is our first year. This is our first year doing our innovation challenge. It is an entrepreneur competition. It is beyond the business plan competition. I wanted to really, through this competition, really highlight the entrepreneur spirit in the county, as well as highlight all the services that we have available to support new and young businesses, all the way from the idea concept to a business that's been in business for less than 3 years. It's a two-part contest, I would say. Is right now the entries were open. We opened the contest in April. The entry deadline was last week. All the entries are being reviewed by our committee. We had twice the number of entries than we had expected, which is fantastic. So I think my committee is going to be very challenged in deciding who to identify. On Thursday, September 14th at 5:30 at Marist College, we'll be having a pitch competition of the four semifinalists. There are two categories. There's a pre-venture and a young business category. There are going to be two semifinalists from each category. They're going to pitch their idea in front of a panel of judges as well as the audience. The audience will be giving two play money dollars, and at the end of the event, they can vote on which business they would, you know, quote-unquote, invest in. And then the winner will be announced on October 19th at our Business Excellence Awards. The winner of our Innovation Challenge will win a tremendous amount of business services, a one-year membership to our local chamber, business counseling from not only our, you know, partner organizations like SCORE, SBDC, WEDSI, but also some of our local businesses on, you know, we have a local accounting firm that has offered to provide free accounting services and consultation. We have a risk management firm. We have a marketing firm. And then on top of that, the winner will be also, we'll be doing a feature story on the winners, and they'll appear, you know, in local and hopefully national media, you know. So
what are the criteria for judging in the first couple of rounds before the competition?
So the businesses will be judged on I would say the realistic aspects of their of the business, the potential for their business. You know, part of the requirements to enter was to have some kind of business or financial plan submitted, so that we have an understanding of, you know, what resources they have. That it's just not just like, hey, I have a great idea, but really that they've really thought it out and how they would launch their idea or how they would like to grow, and things like that. So they'll be judged on the quality of and the realism, you know, realistic expectations of that, and if there's a market, you know, one of the things that they had to prove is why they think their product, you know, it would be successful. So, you know, evidence of why that is. Mm-hmm. So they'll be judged on that, and then at the pitch competition, they'll be judged on the quality of getting their message across. You know, how persuasive are they? You know, are they, it's going to be very much like Shark Tank, watching Shark Tank, you know.
And so is this open to the public?
It is open to the public. It is, we will be selling tickets to the event. It's $40 for the event, $45 at the door. And, but it's open to the public.
So is it set up like in an auditorium?
So it'll be at an auditorium at Marist College. We think so we reserve the auditorium, but the auditorium actually is limited by the number of space, and we've had a lot of interest, so we reserved an even bigger room, and so depending on how many RSVPs we get, and we're actually taking reservations now, and depending on how many we get will depend on which room we'll eventually take. But we're also limited. Even the biggest room we have is somewhat limited. So
what's the largest capacity?
So the largest capacity is 150. So the auditorium can fit 100, and the larger room can fit 150. So
are you going to like stream the event or anything, or record it?
So we are going to record it, and we will we're deciding now whether to post it on our website or to edit and then, you know, post it. But we've decided not to stream it live, because we really want people to be there, you know, and be able to participate, because, so we decide not to stream it. But we are going to, you know, hopefully record it. That's our hope. We're still working out the logistics of how that's going to be done, but yeah.
And is this something that you are thinking of doing, like, on an annual basis, or is it like a once in a lifetime, or, yeah, you know?
So we're hoping to do it on an annual basis. You know, we're hoping to make one of our events. This year is the first year, and we've gotten really good response. So, you know, if all goes well at the pitch event, you know, we'll probably do this again next year. So, you know, we plan to do it in this year's the pilot year, with the hopes that we would continue to do it. So,
cool. Sounds interesting. All right. So I have a few final questions that I ask to everyone, since this is a food and health themed podcast as well. These are kind of questions related to that. Okay. So it's not about being an expert in those areas. It's about contributing to a conversation with a wider audience, right? Yeah. So don't feel like, oh my God, I'm not an expert in food and health or whatever, you know?
Yeah.
No, it's about what people really think, you know?
Uh-huh.
Okay, so the first question is, how do you define health or healthy, and why is that important?
Okay. So I define health and healthy as being able to do everything that you want to do, you know, being capable to be able to do everything you do without harming yourself and your body, both and your mentality. So that to me is health and healthy. So regardless of your body shape, your body size, as long as you're able to do what you want to do without harming, you know, bringing harm to yourself, that's healthy.
Okay, and why is that important?
Because I believe that people should, you know, we're only on this earth for a limited amount of time, and you should try to live life to the fullest, and, you know, not being able to do that is, I think, a little sad to me. And yeah. So I think, you know, to be able to enjoy life, and whether that is, you know, eating with your friends and family, your loved ones, or going for a hike, or, you know, being able to, you know, go for a walk, you know, that's really, you know, all the wonderments of life. And, you know, whether enjoying life is to go for an early morning run by yourself, or to walk through your garden, and not being able to do that, you know, is sad.
Okay, and what do you see as the biggest issue facing our society as it relates to food and health?
I think there's so much information out there, you know. There's a lot of information out there. The internet has been, you know, both good and bad. And, you know,
it's a double-edged sword.
It's a double-edged sword. And, you know, you have all these contradicting information. Drink coffee, don't drink coffee. You know, drink wine, don't drink wine. You know, eat paleo. No, eat gluten-free, eat dairy-free, you know. milk is bad, milk is good. So it's... so it's...
Carbs are the devil.
Carbs of the devil, you know. You know, that's the thing. So it's, so there's so much information. Eat, you know, eat towards your blood type, you know, things like that. So there's just so much information out there, and people self-diagnose and self-medicate. It's... it can be really, really daunting. And I think that can be very challenging to really ultimately what is healthy and, you know.
Yeah, to really knowing what healthy is.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. And what is the most exciting thing going on in food and health?
I would say it's almost the same answer, but a different perspective is that there's so much going on.
Yeah.
You know, I think it's really exciting. Like, you know, growing up in, you know, when I did in the 70s and 80s, you know, people ate iceberg lettuce, white bread, you know, American cheese.
But you ate kimchi too.
And I ate kimchi, right? and, you know, and drank whole milk. Now, I go to the grocery store, and next to whole milk is almond milk, soy milk, you know, cashew milk, you know, skim milk. You know, there's so many options out there, and I think that makes it exciting. You know, you can... go to any community now, and you can, you know, this is a little bit, I have a little bit of an issue with this, but, you know, you can have Chinese food, you can have Italian food, you can have Mexican, you know, you can walk the streets and have that, you know, you can have American, there's so many options out there, and you know, it's very exciting, you know, the food movement right now. Eat healthy, you know, eat decadent. That's all available to everybody now.
Yeah. So. Cool. So is there anything else you'd like to add?
No, I think, you know, you kind of like hit hopefully everything that you wanted to talk about. I've enjoyed my time. This, you know, time I've had with you just has flown by. It's almost 2 hours.
Yeah,
I can go on for a lot more.
I know I kept thinking of a lot of things I wanted to ask, but then I'm like, yeah, we're getting to time. So we'll have to have you on again and talk about more things.
Yeah, I would love it. I really have enjoyed my time. And so I think I'm afraid to say, yes, I could talk about it, but then we'd be here for another 2 hours.
So. All right. So how can people get in touch with you and or the Think Duchess Alliance?
So, yes. So the best way to get a hold of me is through our website. Come to thinkduchess.com. Be familiar with us. My contact information is on there. If they want to email me directly, it's sarah@thinkduchess.com. Sarah is spelled S-A-R-A-H. But yeah, that's really the best way to get a hold of me.
And if someone was interested in getting in touch with Think Duchess, are you the primary contact, or should they, you know, reach out to someone else?
So yes, they can reach out to me. I'm more than happy to speak with them. They can also call the general number, which is on, you know, our website, which is 845-463-5400. and they'll be connected to the person that they need to talk to, but I'm more than happy to, you know, talk to them and then, you know, figure that out as well, so.
And if someone wants to attend the Innovation Challenge event, what should they do?
So again, they should go to our website, click on the news tab, news and events, and it'll lead them directly to the Innovation Challenge website. It'll tell them more information about the event and the details and how they can buy a ticket.
Okay, great. Thank you so much.
All right, thank you.